Hello everybody. Welcome to EPG Pathshala to all of you. I am Dr. Varalakshmi. Formerly I was teaching and doing research in political philosophy at Department of Philosophy, Andhra University, Visakhapatnam. Today I am going to deal with the module titled as Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2015. The learning objectives are: this module helps the students to understand the Juvenile Justice Act, liable people, especially minors who commit crimes and are susceptible to punishment. By the end of this module, one will be well versed with the working structure, implementation and monitoring of the programs and various special provisions described in the Act of the Care and Protection and Rehabilitation and Reintegration of Juveniles in Conflict with Law. Introduction. Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2015 has been passed by Parliament of India. It aims to replace the existing Indian Juvenile Delinquency Law, Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2000, so that the juveniles in conflict with law in the age group of 16 to 18 involved in heinous offences can be tried as adults. This act came into force on 15 January 2016. History of this act. After the 2012 Delhi gang rape, it was found that one of the accused was a few months away from being 18. So he was tried in juvenile court. On 31st July 2013, Subramanian Swami, a BJP politician, filed a public interest litigation in the Supreme Court of India seeking that the boy be tried as an adult in a court. In July 2014, Minister for Women and Child Development Maneka Gandhi said that they were preparing a new law which will allow 16 years old also to be tried as an adult. The Gazette of India describes the Juvenile Justice Act as an act to be consolidated and amended as the law relating to children alleged and found to be in conflict with law and children in need of care and protection by catering to the basic needs through proper care, protection, development, treatment, social reintegration, by adopting a child-friendly approach in the adjudication and disposal of matters in the best interest of the children and also for their rehabilitation through processes provided and institutions and bodies established here and under and for matters connected therewith or incidental thereto. Chapter 1 of the Act is preliminary. This Act also may be called as the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2015. This law extends to the whole of India but except to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Notwithstanding anything contained in any other law for the time being in force, the provisions of the Act shall apply to all matters concerning children in need of care and protection and children in conflict with law, including apprehension, detention and prosecution, penalty or imprisonment, or also rehabilitation and social reintegration of children in conflict with law are the matters. Procedures and also procedures and decisions or orders relating to rehabilitation, adoption, reintegration and restoration of children in need of care and protection. Definitions. Article 2 of the Act will provide for the definitions. Accordingly, a child is a person who has not completed his 18 years of age. The definition for a child in conflict with law means a child who is alleged or found to have committed an offence and who has not completed his 18th year of age on the date of commission of this such offence. And definition of abandoned child means a child deserted by his biological or adoptive parents or guardians who has been declared as abandoned by the committee after chapter 2 deals with the general principles of care and protection of children. The central government, the state government, the board and other agencies, as the case may be, while implementing the provisions of this act, shall be guided by the following fundamental principles, namely the principles of presumption of innocence, dignity and worth and participation, and principle of best interests, family responsibility, safety, positive measures, non-stigmatizing semantics, principles of no non-waiver of rights, equality and non-discrimination, principle of right to privacy and confidentiality, institutionalization as a measure of last resort, principle of repatriation and restoration, fresh start, and principle of diversion, natural justice are the things to be considered. Chapter 3. Juvenile Justice Board. A board shall consist of a metropolitan magistrate or a judicial magistrate of first class, not being chief metropolitan magistrate or chief judicial magistrate, hereinafter referred to as principal magistrate, with at least 3 years experience and 2 social workers selected in such a manner as may be prescribed, of whom at least one shall be a woman, forming a bench, and every such bench shall have the powers conferred by the Code of Criminal Procedure 1973, a metropolitan magistrate or as the case may be. Judicial Magistrate of First Class. Chapter 4. This includes procedures in relation to children in conflict with law, apprehension of child alleged to be in conflict with law, and role of person in whose charge child is in conflict with law is placed, and bail to a person who is apparently a child alleged to be in conflict with law, and information to parents, guardians or probation officer, and also with deals with the inquiry by board regarding child in conflict with law, and preliminary assessment into the heinous offences by the board, and orders regarding the child who is not found to be in conflict with the law. Other things are orders regarding child found to be in conflict with law. Other inclusions in this chapter are powers of children's court, and child attained age of 21 years and yet to complete prescribed term of stay in place of safety, order that may not be passed against a child in conflict with law. Proceeding under chapter 8 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, not to apply against the child. No joint proceeding of child in conflict with law and person is not a child. Removal of disqualification on the findings of an offence, and special provisions in respect of pending cases, and also deals with the provisions with respect of runaway child in conflict with law. Chapter 5 deals with the Child Welfare Committee. The state government shall, by notification in the official gazette, constitute for every district one or more child welfare committees for exercising the powers and also to discharge the duties conferred on such committees in relation to children in need of care and protection under this act, and ensure that induction training and sensitization of all members of the committee is provided within 2 months from the date of notification. And such a committee shall consist of a chairperson and 4 other members as the state government may think fit to appoint, of whom at least one shall be a woman and another an expert on the matters concerning children. The functions and responsibilities of the committee shall include 1. Taking cognizance of and receiving the children, to adjust before it, and then conducting inquiry on all issues relating to and affecting the safety and well-being of the children, and under this act, directing the child welfare officers or probation officers or district child protection unit or non-governmental organizations to conduct social investigation and submit a report before the committee. Now, conducting inquiry for declaring fit persons for care of children in need of care and protection, and also directing placement of a child in foster care institution, and ensuring care and protection and also appropriate rehabilitation or restoration of children in need of care and protection, and also based on the child's individual care, planning and passing necessary directions to parents or guardians or fit persons or children's homes or fit facility in this regard. And other duties also include selecting registered institutions for placement of each child, and then conducting at least 2 inspections or visits per month of residential facilities, taking suo moto cognizance of cases and reaching out to children in need of care and protection, and taking action for rehabilitation of sexually abused children who are reported as children in need of care and protection to the committee, and also to coordinate with the police, labor department and other agencies involved in the care and protection of children, accessing appropriate legal services for children, such other functions and responsibilities as may be prescribed. Chapter 6th, procedure in relation to children in need of care and protection. It includes like the procedures like production before committee, mandatory reporting regarding a child found separated from guardian, and offences of non-reporting, penalty of non-reporting and surrender of children, and also deals with the orders passed regarding children in need of care and protection. Procedure for declaring a child legally free or adoption. Chapter 7 deals with rehabilitation and social reintegration of the child. The process of rehabilitation and social reintegration of children under this act shall be undertaken based on the individual care plan of the child, preferably through family based care such as by restoration to family or guardian with or without supervision or sponsorship or adoption or foster care, provided that all efforts shall be made to keep siblings placed in institutional or non-institutional care together, unless it is in the best interest not to be kept together. The process of rehabilitation and social integration of children under this act shall be undertaken based on the individual care and plan of the child, preferably through family-based care such as by restoration to family or guardian with or without supervision or sponsorship or adoption or foster care, provided that all efforts shall be made to keep siblings placed in institutional or non-institutional care together, unless it is in their best interest not to be kept together. Rehabilitation and reintegration services in institutions registered under this act and management thereof is another duty. The services that shall be provided by the institutions registered under this act in the process of rehabilitation and reintegration of children shall be in such manner as may be prescribed, which may include basic requirements such as food, shelter, clothing and medical attention as per the prescribed standards. Equipment such as wheelchairs, prosthetic devices, hearing aids, braille kits or any other suitable aids and appliances as required for children with special needs. Also, appropriate education including supplementary education, special education and appropriate education for children with special needs. Also, inspection of institutions registered under this act. Then, the state government shall appoint inspection committees for the state and district as the case may be for all institutions registered or recognized to fit under this act for such period and for such purposes as may be prescribed. Another function is evaluation of functioning of structure. The central government, the state government may independently evaluate the functioning of board, committee, special juvenile police units and registered institutions or recognized fit facilities and persons at such period and through such persons or institutions as may be prescribed by that government. Chapter 8 then deals with the adoption of children. This chapter includes provisions for procedure for adoption by Indian prospective adoptive parents living in India and procedure for inter-country adoption of an orphan or an abandoned or surrendered child and procedure for inter-country relative adoption and also with effective adoption and adoption shall be resorted for ensuring right to family for the orphan and abandoned and surrendered children as per the provisions of this act. The rules made there under adoption, regulations framed by the authority. Adoption for a child from a relative or by another relative irrespective of their religion can be made as per the provision of this act and the adoption regulation framed by the authority. Nothing in this act shall apply to adoption. The prospective adoptive parents shall be physically fit, financially sound, mentally alert and highly motivated to adopt a child for providing a good upbringing to him. In case of a couple, the consent of both the spouses for the adoption shall be required. Procedure for adoption by Indian prospective adoptive parents living in India. This includes Indian prospective adoptive parents living in India irrespective of their religion. If interested to adopt an orphan or an abandoned or surrendered child may apply for the same to a specialized adoption agency in the manner as provided in the adoption regulations framed by the authority. The specialized adoption agency then shall prepare the home study and also report of the prospective adoptive parents and upon finding them eligible will refer a child declared legally free for adoption to them along with the child study report and medical report of the child in the manner as provided in the adoption regulations. And these are framed by the authority. And it deals with the procedure for inter-country adoption of an orphan or abandoned or surrendered child. If an orphan or abandoned or surrendered child could not be placed with an Indian or non-resident Indian prospective adoptive parent, despite the joint effort of the specialized adoption agency and state agency within 60 days from the date the child has been declared legally free for adoption. Such child shall be free for inter-country adoption, provided that children with physical and mental disability, siblings and children above 5 years of age may be given preference over other children for such inter-country adoption. In accordance with the adoption regulations as may be framed by the authority. And then procedure for inter-country relative adoption. A relative living abroad who intends to adopt a child from his relative in India shall obtain an order from the court and apply for no objection certificate from authority in the manner as provided in the adoption regulations framed by the authority. Effect of adoption. A child in respect of whom an adoption or order is issued by the court shall become the child of the adoptive parents, and the adoptive parents shall become the parents of the child as if the child had been born to the adoptive parents for all purposes, including intestacy, with effect from the date on which the adoption order takes effect and for some such date all the ties of the child in the family of his or her birth shall stand severed and replaced by those created by the adoption order in the adoptive family, provided that any property which has vested in the adopted child immediately before the date on which the adoption order takes effect shall continue to vest in the adopted child, subject to the obligations, if any, attached to the ownership of such property, including the obligations, if any, to maintain the relatives in the biological family. Further, Chapter 9 deals with the other offences against children. Other offences include in this chapter, they are prohibition on disclosure of identity of child, punishment for cruelty of child, and prohibition on disclosure of identity of children, and no report in any newspaper, magazine, news sheet, or audiovisual media or other forms of communication regarding any inquiry or investigation or judicial procedure shall disclose the name, address, or school, or any other particular which may lead to the identification of a child in conflict with law, or a child in need of care and protection, or a child victim or witness of a crime involved in such manner under any other law for the time being in force, nor shall be the picture of any such child be published. Punishment for cruelty of child. This deals with whoever having the actual charge of or control over a child assaults, abandons, abuses, exposes or willfully neglects the child, or causes or procures the child to be assaulted, abandoned, abused, exposed or neglected in a manner likely to cause such a child unnecessary mental or physical suffering shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 3 years, or with fine of 1 lakh rupees, or with both. Whoever gives or causes to be given to any child any intoxicating liquor or any narcotic drug or tobacco products or psychotropic substance, except on the order of a duly qualified medical practitioner, shall be punishable with rigorous imprisonment for a term which may extend to 7 years, and shall also be liable to fine which may extend to 1 lakh rupees. Further, whoever uses a child for vending, peddling, caring, supplying or smuggling or any intoxicating liquor or narcotic drug or psychotropic substance, they shall be liable for rigorous imprisonment for a term which may extend to 7 years, and shall also be liable to fine up to 1 lakh rupees. Then, notwithstanding anything contained in any law, for the time being in force, whoever ostensibly engages a child and keeps him in bondage for the purpose of employment, or withholds his earnings, or uses such earning for his own purpose, shall be punishable with rigorous imprisonment for a term which may extend to 5 years, and shall also be liable to fine of 1 lakh rupees. Then we will come to the chapter 10, which deals with miscellaneous provisions. Here, the committee or the board, as the case may be, before which a child is brought under any of the provisions of this act, may, whatever it so thinks fit, require any parent or guardian having the actual charge of the child to be present at any proceeding in respect of that child. Other miscellaneous details of the act are described under this chapter, which mainly include or attendance of a parent or guardian of a child, and dispensing with attendance of child, and placement of child suffering from disease requiring prolonged medical treatment in an approved place, transfer of a child who is mentally ill or addicted to alcohol or other drugs, and presumption and determination of age, and transfer of a child to place of residence, and transfer of child between children's home or special homes, or fit facility or fit person in different place parts of India, release of a child from an institution, leave of absence to a child placed in an institution, reports to be treated as confidential, protection of action taken in good faith, procedure in inquiries, appeals and revision procedures, and powers of the committee or the board to amend its own orders, juvenile justice fund, state children protection society and district child protection unit, and child welfare police officer and special juvenile police unit, public awareness on provisions of the act and monitoring of the implementation of the act, and the National Commission for Protection of Children's Rights constituted under Section 3, or as the case may be, the state government, or the State Commission for Protection of Child Rights constituted under Section 17, herein referred to as the National Commission or the State Commission, as the case may be, of the Commissions for Protection of Child Rights Act, shall, in addition to the functions assigned to them under the said Act, also monitor the implementation of the provisions of this Act in such a manner as may be prescribed. Monitoring of implementation of Act. In this regard, the National Commission, or the, as the case may be, the State Government, State Commission, shall, while inquiring into any matter relating to any offence under this Act, have the same powers as are vested in the National Commission or the State Commission under the Commission for Protection of Child Rights Act 2005. Now we shall see some critical points. Criticism includes Child Rights Activists and Women Rights Activities have called the bill a regressive step and have criticized the bill Many experts and activists viewed this post December 2012 Delhi gang rape responses as a creation of media sensationalization of the issue and cautioned against any regressive move to disturb the momentum of juvenile justice legislation in the country. Criticism also includes, however, some sections of the society felt that in view of terrorism and other serious offences, Juvenile Justice Act 2000 needed to be amended to include punitive approaches in the existing juvenile justice law, which so far is purely rehabilitative and reformative. Some also argued that there is no need of tampering with the Juvenile Justice Act for putting up an effective deterrent against terrorism. However, some sections in the society felt that in view of terrorism and other serious offences, Juvenile Justice Act of 2000 needed to be amended to include punitive approaches in the existing juvenile justice law, which so far is only purely rehabilitative and reformative. Some argued that there is no need of tampering with the Juvenile Justice Act for putting up effective deterrent against terrorism. Summary: the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children of Act 2015, with its elaborate provisions for juvenile in conflict with law, is very important intervention for two reasons. One, the changing lifestyles and impact on young mind to behave deviant are causing harm to girl children. Another is criminal tendencies on the other hand. Another is these young minds need a protection as well as rehabilitation and reformation. Hence, taking into consideration of opinions of social scientists and psychologists, this welcoming act is expected to provide the reformatory needs of the society. Thank you.